Do you want to pause the recording?
Yes.
I'm going to hop onto Facebook and see if we can share here.
We're going to start seeing everything.
Yep, might disappear for a second.
Okay. You want me to watch your personal Facebook feed to let you know if it shows up there? There's Laura. Is Laura on that duty?
Laura's on that duty. But
okay, good. Thank you, Laura.
And now I remember not to share it to my own timeline. We should be good.
Mm-hmm. Good morning.
Morning, Melissa.
And we're on. We're on Facebook. Yay! Hi, Facebookies.
Getting easier every week, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Well, sometimes.
We're going to be training some more people to be what Ken is calling Zoom masters. We've had some people volunteer to help co-host these and help Rebecca and Pastor Joel out. So we're going to have a Zoom master class tomorrow at 1 o'clock.
Not including me, that's for sure.
Me neither.
Me neither. Get those young people.
Okay, Charlene, if you don't want to, that's fine. But, you know, anybody else is welcome.
Everybody else is there, yeah.
If I didn't have Bruce and Shauna next door, I'd be in big trouble.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I see, Peggy. You would try, but I don't think your internet would accommodate. So
hey, Melissa, you know there's some character standing behind you there.
Yeah, he's a character, all right. He hovers.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning. Pretty flowers. Are those out of your yard, Patel?
Oh, my glads. Yes. I was telling people earlier, I picked them so the deer wouldn't eat them.
Oh.
they have been, yeah.
How's the corn coming along?
It is huge, and it's going to be ready in a week.
Oh, really?
Boy, that is
really early. Yeah.
Hmm. I see, Trish, you're in Seattle, huh? You're muted.
You're muted.
Can't hear you.
There she is.
There. I'm in Yelm, and this is a very unstable connection.
Oh. No. Okay. How was the bus ride?
Backing off of a neighbor's Wi-Fi, and we're out in the woods.
Great. How was the bus ride?
Long.
In Seattle, or did you get? Did they change in Everett, or?
No, we stayed on the bus all the way through.
All the way. Oh, okay.
Yeah. I can't get it to go up.
Okay, I'm
having trouble with my internet on my laptop. So, hi, everybody. The one request I have, everyone, please make a note right now. Sit down, make a pretty card or interesting card, send it to Ron. He's at the hospital room 241, bed one. And he's not, things aren't good.
What's going on with him?
I can't go into details, HIPAA, et cetera, but he is going to be put in a nursing center. Yes, room 241, bed one.
So if we just address it to Peace Health Hospital and their address?
Yeah, St. Joseph's. I can't remember Peace Health, St. Joseph. I don't remember the actual site or the actual address off the top of my head, but I thought of it.
He's up at the main hospital up there on Squalicum, right? Yes. Yeah. Okay. I might ask Rebecca
to put it out.
Yeah. Okay. Or if I can get the address real quick, I'll put it in the chat.
Thank you.
Room 241, bed 1.
Okay. Yes.
Good. How long will it be in? Okay.
I don't know. They're making evaluations and stabilizing him to get him to a nursing center.
Okay. All right. 10:31.
Okay. Yep. So let's take a deep breath and we'll let Roger welcome us and bring us together in worship this morning. Thank you, Roger. For some announcements this morning, Marta has one about the backpacks.
Hey, kids are going back to school in person this year. And for the last several years, we have collected in the summertime backpacks for children who don't have the access to purchasing one for the needed supplies that they need. So we're going to again collect those, and you can drop them off at the church during office hours. So check your e-news to see what Rebecca's office hours are. And if we would have them to the church by August 27th, that's a Thursday, then I'll put them in my car and take pictures and we'll take them up to the district office for our students in the Ferndale School District who need a little extra help. It's expensive to buy backpacks, but they're on sale right now, so go for it.
Okay, and then Lisa, if I can find you on my, there you are. Would you like to share how we did with the book drive?
Oops, I just stopped my video. There we go. Absolutely. So we had the book drive yesterday for Interfaith Coalition's Learning Center and Kids Need Books program, which will be starting up again, hopefully this fall, we all hope. And it went really, really well. We got a lot of donations. So the trunk of my car now has 10 banker's boxes full of children's books that I'm going to get up to Interfaith later this week. And Linda Berlowski called me yesterday and said she has a few more. I'm going to swing by and pick them up. So we still have a couple of days. So if you have kids' books that you'd like to donate, give me a call and I'll pick them up. But I was very pleased. We were all very pleased with how well it went. Thank you all.
Great. And then I have an announcement, which I will get to later on during the service. But I don't currently have my cell phone with me right now. So I'm trying to monitor the chat on Facebook, but for our Facebook friends, bear with us. You can keep on chatting in there if you would like to. Laura's helping me out with trying to monitor that in the background. In the meantime, as we gather together for worship, let us center ourselves with the centering words and our guided meditation. Let us begin by humbly acknowledging that we gather today on the ancestral homelands of the Coast Salish peoples who have lived in the Salish Sea Basin throughout the San Juan Islands and the North Cascade watershed from time immemorial. Please join me in expressing our deepest respect and gratitude for our indigenous neighbors, the Lummi Nation and the Nootsack tribe, for their enduring care and protection of our shared lands and waterways. While at the same time, we as the church repent for all the harms that we have caused throughout our history. If you live in another part of the United States or in another country, I invite you to find out who first lived on the land you are living on, and whose backbreaking labor built it into the community we know it as today. May we commit to working alongside our neighbors to protect Mother Earth. Let us center ourselves in silence and breathe deeply as we prepare to worship the beauty and the goodness of the divine. And may we remind ourselves that no matter who you are, no matter where on life's journey you are welcome here.
Good morning, everyone. Our first hymn today is All Who Hunger.
Who hunger, gather gladly. Holy manna is our bread. Come from wilderness and wandering, here in truth we will be fed. You that yearn for days of fullness, all around us is food. Taste and see the grace eternal. Taste and see that God is good. All who hunger, never strangers, seeker be a welcome guest. Come from restlessness and roaming, here in joy we keep the feast. We that once were lost and scattered, in communion's love have stood. Taste and see the grace eternal. eternal taste and see that God is good. All who hunger sing together, Jesus Christ is living bread. Come from loneliness and longing, here in peace we have been led. Blessed are those who from this table live their lives in gratitude. Taste and see the grace eternal, taste and see that God is good, God is good, God is good.
Join me in the opening prayer. O God, who gives us Jesus, who is bread from heaven, fill us with the nourishment of faith, faith that is both thought and deed. When we feel lost and alone and abandoned, mix us together as essential ingredients in your recipe of communion. When we feel punched down by life, continue to raise us up with the Spirit's yeast. When we finally feel complete and whole and ready, break us into pieces so that we may feed an aching world. Thus we come, O Christ, together to witness and to follow. Amen. Accept one another with love, as we have been accepted with love in the unity of God's Spirit. Let us exchange signs of God, of Christ's peace. Peace be with you. And also with you.
Well, kids, today I thought I would do a little talking with you about food again. Last week we talked about food. Do you remember we had the fish and we had, I think we had tuna fish and didn't we have kippers? And today, did you bring bread? I hope folks have bread, remembering that though this is the first, it's Communion Sunday. And maybe you brought a little juice or something with you too to celebrate communion. Well, in looking around at the church, I was reminded of something. Let me see here. I got a bunch of windows open. If I pull up this photo that I took, and we'll see if you guys can see it. Here we go. So do you see the bread photo? How it says, be gentle when you touch bread. So I just thought that would be a good thing to kind of remember as we move through life, but as we, especially on these Sundays, which we're talking about Jesus being the bread of life and thinking about bread. Now, I have a funny kind of story about bread that some of our friends told us. And our friends started dating in college. And when they were dating, they had this moment where it was the first time that one side of the family showed up at the dinner table. And Greg knew that Lydia's family had been living in Europe for a long time. So they said, well, I think Europeans eat a lot of bread, so we should have bread at the table. Nobody ate any of the bread that was sitting there on the table at dinner time. But the next time that Lydia's family had Greg's family over for dinner, they said, well, I don't know what it is, but these Americans seem to eat a lot of bread. So maybe we should have bread on the table. And nobody ate bread. It was kind of humorous stories about how we sometimes have misconceptions about people, but we can always remember that it's really in the gathering together where we're really fed, not just in what we eat, but our hearts are fed when we gather together, right? So as you go forth with Rosalind and gather together, know that not only are you fed in the community with that's gathered here, but that God loves you also, as do all of us, okay? And we'll sing you on off to class.
May the love of God fill you from your head down to your toes. May it wiggle through your fingers and dance upon your nose. May the people all around you help you live so loving grows. May the love of God fill you up until it overflows.
All right. As we come into our time of prayers of the people, let us pray. O gracious one, we give you thanks for the pets that have gathered around us and that keep us company throughout this pandemic time, who have kept us company in the midst of being kept at home. Even those pets who suddenly, though it's questionable whether who can hear them, gallop through and start meowing as I start the prayers of the people. Oh, Holy One, we ask that you be with those who are fighting fires. As the wildfires have come through once again this season, we ask that you help those who are dealing with the smoke, with the asthma or whatever else they may be suffering, that they might feel your presence. Oh Lord, in your great love, we pray. Oh Lord, we pray for those who are in the hospital, remembering especially this morning, Ron. May they all be touched with the love and the care that the nurses and the hospital staff extend. And may they see your presence in that process. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers.
And in your love, answer.
Lord, we pray for all of those who are suffering from COVID. We especially think about the massive outbreak that has happened in Providence, Massachusetts, but knowing that there are other places in the world where outbreaks are happening. We give you thanks for the scientists and for science that allows us some hope with the vaccine. But we're oh so well aware of the disparities between countries that can get vaccinated and have those opportunities in countries where the population is still awaiting vaccinations to arrive. O Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. O Lord, we give you thanks for the ways in which you are at work in the world, especially through that sense of community who can pray for one another. So we give you thanks for our friend who has recovered from COVID, but also for folks like Stan, who belongs to some of our neighbors and therefore makes him one of our neighbors who's also recovering. We ask that they might feel your sense of presence in the larger community. Lord, in your mercy, Hear our prayer. Lord, sometimes there's tragic news that reaches our ears too. And so we pray for Dan and his family as he has suddenly been struck, has suddenly died unexpectedly. So as the community of Blaine especially reels with what that might mean, may the family experience your presence and a sense of comfort in this time as the community gathers around them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And looking at the chat, what else is upon our hearts this week that we would like to lift up in prayer?
Prayers for Andrea and Carrie, Jaden and Sanaya.
O Lord, in your great love and mercy, hear our prayers.
Our children and grandchildren, as they go through all of this uncertainty relating to going back to school, they hear so many things. They are not immune to the news, even if we try to hide those realities from them. Please give them comfort and knowledge that you are with them no matter what happens. Help their family to be reassuring. Amen.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. From Facebook, I see that we have a prayer for Andrea. She is struggling with lupus. Or maybe it's Andrea. Lord, in your prayer, or in your great mercy, hear our prayers.
Our son-in-law, Bill, he was hit in the head with a golf ball while he was out golfing and had to have stitches. And so he's doing better.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
And in your love, answer.
Yes. Lord, we come together and we pray as you have taught us. Sing our Creator who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your reign come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the reign, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The power. Prayer of Illumination. God seeks to guide us into mature adulthood. Listen for God's nourishing word that we may grow in the knowledge and the love of Christ. The scripture this morning is from John chapter 6, verses 24 through 34 from the Inclusive Bible. The bread of life. When the people saw that neither Jesus nor the disciples were there, they got into their boats and crossed to Capernaum looking for Jesus. When they found Jesus on the other side of the lake, they said, "Rabbi, when did you get here?" Jesus answered them, "The truth of the matter is, you're not looking for me because you've seen signs, but because you've eaten your fill of the bread. You shouldn't be working for perishable food, but for life-giving food that lasts for all eternity. This the chosen one can give you. for the chosen one bears the seal of heavenly parent. At this, they said, what must we do to perform the works of God? Jesus replied, this is the work of God, to believe in the one whom God has sent. So they asked Jesus, what sign are you going to give to show us that we should believe in you? What will you do? Our ancestors had manna to eat in the desert. As scripture says, God gave them bread from heaven to eat. Jesus said to them, the truth of the matter is, Moses hasn't given you bread from heaven, yet my heavenly parent gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is the one who comes down from heaven and gives the life to the world. Teacher, they said, give us this bread from now on. Jesus explained to them, I am the bread of life. No one who comes to me will ever be hungry. No one who believes in me will ever be thirsty. Holy wisdom, holy word. Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Okay, so funny sort of story today, which may explain why I'm slightly frazzled this morning. So Laura and I moved back on board last night. This morning I got up, thinking about the sermon, thinking about church, thinking about kind of those sorts of things and doing the typical, probably most pastors, Sunday morning experience. Although I'm not sure how many pastors actually go up to a bathhouse and then take a shower in the bathhouse. But I'm thinking, you know, kind of praying and thinking through the Sunday service. When I come out of the bathhouse, out of my shower stall, and realize my shirt is hanging up, my glasses are there, my watch is there, my bath kind of bag is there, my pants are not there. Yep, you heard that. My pants are not there. I was very thankful that I had a very big towel, which I wrapped around myself, put my shirt on and my shoes on, and then kind of walked around from the shower side to the bathroom side to ask if anybody had seen my pants. And of course, I can't believe that this has happened. And so I'm looking, checking other shower stalls, like, what is going on? So my pants have disappeared, which means my wallet's in there, my car keys are in there, all my phones in there, all that kind of stuff. So of course, that's why I don't have my phone with me. Now we might think in some ways, oh, my life is over, but it's not really. I mean, believe it or not, well, the kids are gone, but believe it or not, I grew up in a place before cell phones. I know it's possible. Right? It's kind of a bummer having to call and cancel perhaps some credit cards. The funny thing is that though they stole stuff, there wasn't any money in my wallet, so I'm not sure what they would have gotten. And because we have a good community around us, we were able to come into a friend's house, hence a new background for you, to borrow their Wi-Fi, right? I still had my computer. I'm still able to get online. And I'm reminded, yeah, we don't always just live by bread alone. Though it's kind of handy. And so I think about, in some ways, these disciples and this community that John Gospel is talking about and what the community of John is dealing with. And just to pull us back up to speed a bit, remember that John's community and that John has written roughly somewhere between 80 and 100, what we would call the common era now. So the temple has already been destroyed. And so who is coming to power then within the synagogue sort of relationships as to who's going to be true components of carrying on the Jewish faith? The Sadducees were temple-based, they're gone. The priests were temple-based, they're gone, which is why they don't really show up much in John's gospel. But you have the Pharisees and you have this new Christian group following Jesus. And we're watching an internal sort of scrapping back and forth. To kind of put this somewhat in perspective, and for you of British descent, sorry, but it was reminded to Laura and I when we were in Massachusetts and were going through Boston and watching things happen at Boston, that Paul Revere, number one, didn't make the ride. He fell off his horse. Peggy, you might get a kick out of this. He wasn't thrown, he fell off his horse. And so he didn't make the ride. But the other two would not have been yelling, "The British are coming," because they were, most of them were British. Instead, it was "The Redcoats are coming." But because we in the United States talk about this as and somewhat of an internal struggle, we always then end up talking about the British were coming. So it is with John's gospel when they're arguing about, in some ways, who it is who's right and who it is who's wrong. The Judeans in that southern kingdom have a very different sort of outlook on what's happening in John's gospel. So within the synagogue community of that John's gospel would have been written for and with, the Galilean on the north would have been a bit different. In some ways, some of the scholars were pulling up and drawing comparisons between what's happening in chapter 6 of John's gospel with what happened before in chapter 4 of John's gospel, where we have Jesus coming into Samaria and meeting the woman at the well, and she's looking for living water and can't quite figure out that Jesus is talking about himself. Because what's happening? She's saying, "Well, if you gave me this living water, I won't have to keep coming to the well all the time." And so it is with this group who got fed out in the wilderness around Passover when they're remembering ritually the leaving of Egypt and the hanging out in the desert over those 40 years. Jesus comes forth and doesn't give them manna from heaven, gives them bread and fish from a boy who had 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. They then come looking for Jesus. And in that process of looking for Jesus, they encounter him and are wondering, "So what's going on now?" We too want to eat forever. And Jesus is saying, "But I am the bread of life. If you but believe in me, you can be working towards those things for eternal bread in heaven." But what does that mean? Sometimes it's funny because I'm thinking about the scripture lesson that's coming up. And then I run into folks who engage me in conversation, and the conversations somehow, maybe it's because I'm thinking about what's coming, but reflect and deal a bit with this. And I've had some numerous conversations with some folks this past week who grew up in very conservative, evangelical sort of background, in which they would say, "Well, isn't it about knowing the precise moment that you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior into your heart?" And yet, these people have been telling me, talking to me about it and going, I always had this feeling that then you could do anything you wanted to afterwards. And that led us into conversations about things, about isn't it actually a moment by moment decision? Isn't it come in small things and big things? But we're driving our car and we see somebody stopped at the crosswalk. Do we stop and let them pass in front of us? Do we hold the door open for somebody at the bank? Do we encounter somebody who's having a rough day and choose really to see them as being created in the image of Christ? Do we give of ourselves in all sorts of ways? Whether it be kids' books or backpacks or caring for those amongst us or who might live down the street. I think it's in all of these things that we suddenly realize, yeah, we don't just live by bread alone. And following Christ, we see the image of the divine in one another. And we can share that love back and forth. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Joel. This next song is called Hungry, Falling on My Knees. Hungry, I come to you.
his heart is living for.
Now we're going to share our blessings. Let us take this time to give thanks to God for life, faith, and community. Let us give thanks to God through the offering our gifts and ourselves. Let us join together in our morning offering. As you prepare your offerings, say a prayer for the mission and ministry of this church. You may send your offerings to P.O. Box 186, Ferndale, Washington, or visit our homepage at ucf1.org and look for the donation button or ask your bank about automatic deposit. Prayer of dedication for our offering. For calling us into ministry with you, we give thanks and praise, O God, for gracing us with gifts and abundance. We are ever grateful. Bless these gifts we now dedicate to you that they may nourish others with the grace of your presence. In gratitude, we pray. Amen.
Amen. And now is a chance to come together and to make sure you have your elements from home as we join together in prayer. Well, living God, we give you thanks for the ways that you are with us. Ways that you are with all of creation. And so we lift up our hearts. We lift them up to you. You who come and dwell amongst us. You in whom we swim in your presence. You are so close to us. O Holy One, we praise and we bless you for being the source of our life. For your spirit has always been with creation, infusing forth life, bringing forth beauty, inspiring joy and love. In your infinite love, you created us in your image. And you breathed into us this breath of life. You gave us a home in this beautiful world to live in harmony with you and one another and all of your creatures. And no matter how we have treated you, you have always remained faithful to us. You graciously called us to turn and to see you in one another. Living among us, Jesus loved us both in word and in deed. And as Jesus proclaimed the good news, he often would break bread with strangers, break bread with others. And as the gospel today came forth and said, I am the bread of life. And as he gathered, he often took the cup, often the cup that was offered to him. And on that last evening that he gathered with his disciples to share the Passover meal, he said profound things, that he is the bread of life and that Jesus claimed to be the wine of the new covenant. So as we gather around this table, though we may be scattered together, we know that our hearts have been gathered up into over 12 basketfuls of flowing food. We remember that indeed you show amongst us in the breaking of the bread and in the sharing of the cup. Amen. So these are holy things for the holy people of God. And invite you to partake.
Please join me in the prayer following communion. We go to follow you, O Jesus, who gives us the bread of life. We go to walk in your ways, O Christ, who strengthens us in our inner being through the power of you, O Holy Spirit. We go to serve you, our living Creator, who gathers the fragments of our lives that nothing may be lost. Amen.
Please join me in singing the doxology. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Alleluia, alleluia. Praise God, the source of all our gifts. Praise Jesus Christ, whose power uplifts. Praise the Spirit, Holy Spirit. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. The closing hymn today is Together We Serve. May we go forth in service throughout our upcoming week. And so we gather to get today, even though you might be a little frazzled like me, giving thanks for the large community and the ways in which we can be reminded of God's love, not only for us, but for the whole of creation. So go in peace as you love and serve the Lord. Thank you.
Thank you, Roger. Wanted to give thanks before we break up into our groups for those who want to stay. And before we say goodbye to our Facebook group, wanted to give thanks for Marta for helping with liturgy this morning, for Lisa helping behind the scenes with the Zoom wizardry, and for Roger and Veronica for their playing. And of course, all of you who are here, both either on Zoom or Facebook Live. Thank you. So now let us wave to our Facebook friends. Know that we love you. Mm-hmm.